Many space startups I've covered on this channel are focused on extracting off-world resources to power the cislunar economy. It's not only startup companies that have an eye on these resources though. Major aerospace companies such as Lockheed Martin have proposed extracting lunar water ice to drive an off-world economy. Check out my video on Lockheed Martin's compelling water-based lunar architecture vision. Tori Bruno, the CEO of United Launch Alliance, the company that launches Atlas V and the new Vulcan Centaur rockets, authored a paper on using propellant stations in orbit on the surface of the moon to kickstart an off-world economy. The next question is, where are the best places to find these resources, especially water ice? Water is a game changer, serving as a propellant either directly or by splitting it into hydrogen and oxygen for chemical thruster engines. Blue Origin relies on liquid hydrogen and oxygen for the upper stage of its New Glenn rocket, the cislunar transporter, and its lunar landers, highlighting the critical role of water-derived propellants in cislunar navigation. Sourcing abundant propellant off-world slashes the cost and complexity of moving through cislunar space, paving the way for expanded activity across the solar system. In a May 2025 conference paper, researchers from the University of Colorado, alongside the founder of Industrial CNT, a carbon nanotube manufacturer, proposed a technical framework for scalable resource extraction and transportation from Ceres. The paper, linked in the video description, is highly technical, so I'll provide a non-technical overview here. Check out the full paper for all the nitty-gritty details. Their plan consists of three core components. 1. Smart mining technology to extract resources efficiently. 2. A space elevator to lift materials out of Ceres' weak gravity well. And 3. An efficient water-based propulsion system to transport harvested water to where it's needed. The researchers estimate that the space elevator can release over 6 tons of harvested water to various destinations. While transportation consumes a significant portion of the propellant, efficient water-based propulsion could still deliver several tons of water to cislunar space. The paper positions Ceres as a pivotal hub for interplanetary logistics, potentially unlocking not just the inner solar system, but also the outer planets and beyond. So, why focus on Ceres? Let's explore that next. Ceres, a key resource hub for space exploration. Ceres could be comprised of 25% water by mass. If that is correct, Ceres has more water than Earth does. The NASA Dawn mission confirmed water ice in craters like OXO and ammonium-rich deposits in regions such as Dantu, ideal for producing rocket fuel directly on Ceres. With gravity just 3% of Earth's, lower than the Moon or Mars, Ceres makes launching materials into space remarkably easy. Its stable orbit and minimal axial tilt ensure consistent conditions, enabling year-round mining without seasonal disruptions. The paper's big idea is using a space elevator to move harvested water ice up from the surface of Ceres to orbit. Let's look into that idea next. The space elevator idea. The cornerstone of the Ceres resource extraction plan is a space elevator, a revolutionary system featuring a super strong cable, or tether, extending 30,000 kilometers from Ceres' surface to an orbiting platform. By leveraging Ceres' rapid 9-hour rotation, the tether remains taut, allowing robotic climbers to transport up to 6,354 kilos of resources, such as water, into orbit. Compared to traditional rockets, this elevator slashes the energy required to escape Ceres' weak gravity by up to 60%, drastically reducing fuel costs and making resource mining far more practical. It also boosts mission flexibility, offering 7 times more launch windows, eliminating the need to wait for precise orbital alignments, a common constraint for missions to Mars or beyond. This positions Ceres as a potential refueling hub for spacecraft heading to Mars, Jupiter, or even back to Earth. Thanks to Ceres' low gravity, only 3% of Earth's, high-strength polymers like Kevlar or Xylon are suitable materials for the tether. In previous videos, I've explored a lunar space elevator, noting that materials suitable for the Moon, such as high-strength polymers, also work for Ceres due to its low gravity. The conference paper proposes carbon nanotubes for the 30,000-kilometer tether, but current manufacturing limits their production to small quantities, making them a future prospect rather than a near-term solution. Instead, Xylon, a high-strength polymer, offers a practical alternative for now. A single-strand Xylon tether stretching 30,000 kilometers would have a mass of approximately 245 kilos with protective coatings. However, producing a defect-free cable over such an immense length is currently impossible, as flaws typically occur every 10 to 100 kilometers, compromising reliability. To make a practical tether, given inevitable flaws, multiple strands could be wrapped around each other. This increases the mass, but makes the tether robust and reliable. Braiding multiple Xylon tethers is a feasible and effective strategy to address inevitable flaws in a 30,000-kilometer Sirius Space Elevator tether. Braiding works because if a single strand has a critical flaw, the remaining strands can bear the load, preventing catastrophic failure. Multiple strands reduce load evenly, resulting in lower stress at defect sites. This technique is already used on Earth for high-performance ropes, requiring no new technology, just optimization of the number of strands to balance increased mass against improved reliability. A 5-strand braid, with each strand designed to carry 50% of the load, reduces failure risk by distributing stress and isolating defects, increasing reliability without excessive mass penalties. The braided tether's estimated mass is 563 kilos, with coatings and redundancy. Challenges such as increased manufacturing complexity and potential friction between strands can be addressed with advanced coatings to address ultraviolet and micrometeorite protection, plus rigorous quality control. These measures make Xylon a practical choice for a Sirius Space Elevator, turning water into rocket fuel. The next key idea for this plan to work is to use the harvested water as rocket fuel. This is not a new idea. Space startups like Momentus have already demonstrated water-based propulsion in low Earth orbit. Startups like Argo Space have plans to harvest lunar water ice and are developing rocket engines to use the extracted resources for powering spacecraft in cislunar space. The paper examines different water-based propulsion systems to figure out which make the most sense for transporting water back to cislunar space or other destinations. A few different propulsion systems were considered. Water electrolysis splits water into hydrogen and oxygen, then burns them for thrust, like a mini rocket engine. Water resistojets heats water into steam for simple, low-power thrust, best for small satellites. Water arc jets uses electric arcs to create hot plasma, offering strong thrust but tricky to stabilize. And microwave electrothermal thrusters, or METs. These heat water vapor with microwaves for super efficient thrust, up to 800 seconds of specific impulse. That's a measure of fuel efficiency. After comparing these propulsion systems, METs stand out for their efficiency and ability to use Sirius water, making them ideal for fueling missions from the space elevator's orbital depot. Argo Space is developing the Argonaut spacecraft that uses MET for propulsion. It's scheduled to fly on SpaceX's Transporter 16 mission in February 2026. For more on Argo Space and their lunar water ice harvesting plans, check out my dedicated video on them. Okay, with the transportation figured out, what about mining water on Ceres? What's the plan for that? Mining water on Ceres. To extract water from Ceres, the researchers propose microwave drying as the most effective mining technique. A rover equipped with a conveyor belt transports Ceres soil through a microwave chamber where heat releases water vapor for collection. This method stands out for its simplicity, durability, and energy efficiency, using roughly half the power of alternative approaches. Its scalability also allows it to expand to meet growing demands. Equipped with tools like LiDAR, the rover autonomously identifies water-rich areas, essential since Earth's distance is too far for real-time control. Powering these operations requires significant energy to make large-scale resource extraction feasible. Given the distance to Ceres from the Sun is 2.8 AU, where solar energy is weak, solar panels are impractical for meeting the mining operation needs. Next, let's explore the team's recommendations for powering the mining operation. powering the Ceres mining operation. Ceres lies far from the Sun at 2.8 AU, nearly three times Earth's distance, making solar panels impractical. To generate sufficient electricity, solar arrays would need to be enormous and heavy, making them difficult to transport. The paper proposes radioisotope thermoelectric generators, or RTGs for short, powered by plutonium-238 to deliver reliable, steady electricity. However, I recommend an alternative, Xenopower's strontium-90-based RTGs, developed by a space startup working on power solutions for spacecraft and lunar landers. Xeno recently partnered with iSpace to supply RTGs for lunar missions, ensuring landers survived the 14-day lunar night. What are RTGs? RTGs convert heat from radioactive decay into electricity, offering simple, dependable power for long durations. The power output and lifespan depend on the isotope used. Strontium-90 provides some distinct advantages over plutonium-238. It provides almost twice as much power, at least to begin with. It does, however, emit more beta radiation, requiring heavier shielding, which could potentially increase the mass of the batteries. However, Xeno's patented lightweight designs mitigate this drawback. Strontium-90 is more abundant and cheaper than the scarce, costly plutonium-238, which is tightly controlled for high-priority missions. Why choose Xenopower? Xenopower's credibility makes them an ideal partner for Ceres mining, where solar power falls short. They hold over $60 million in contracts with NASA and the US Department of Defense, and are developing lunar surface missions for 2027, including a demonstration with iSpace. Their compact modular RTGs, some as small as a shoebox, fit the needs of rovers and mining equipment, offering scalable power solutions. With a goal to deliver systems by 2026, Xeno aligns perfectly with the timelines of space startups aiming to establish a cislunar economy. For larger scale mining operations, for instance over 10,000 tons of water per mine, surface nuclear fission is the only practical power source. Okay, let's move on to some of the challenges of this mining plan. Challenges. Building this system isn't easy. There are a number of engineering challenges that would need to be overcome first. Autonomous operations. Ceres distance from Earth, resulting in signal delays of 14 to 32 minutes, rules out real-time human control. Autonomous mining and processing robots are essential, capable of independently navigating Ceres' rugged terrain, identifying water-rich deposits, and operating the space elevator. These systems require advanced AI to adapt to low gravity, only 3% of Earth's, and unpredictable surfaces, ensuring reliable, self-sufficient operations. Dust mitigation. Dust, kicked up by mining activities or micrometeoroid impacts, poses a major threat to equipment and the space elevator's components, such as climbers. This challenge mirrors issues faced on the Moon and Mars, where dust clogs machinery and degrades surfaces. NASA and other space agencies, through the Artemis program, are developing dust mitigation strategies, such as electromagnetic barriers and filters, which could be adapted for Ceres to protect rovers and tethers. Power supply. Ceres' location at 2.8 AU from the Sun makes solar power impractical, as large, heavy solar arrays would be needed to generate sufficient electricity. For small-scale mining, radioisotope thermoelectric generators, or RTGs, like those proposed with Strontium-90 by Xenopower, offer a compact, reliable solution. For industrial-scale operations requiring thousands of tons of regolith to be processed, surface nuclear fission reactors are necessary. Startups like Antares are developing mini nuclear reactors for lunar and Martian missions, while Lockheed Martin is advancing deployable nuclear reactors for the Moon, both of which could power Ceres mining infrastructure. Overcoming these challenges, autonomy, dust, and power, are critical to transforming Ceres into a sustainable resource hub for interplanetary exploration. Final thoughts. It certainly is an exciting future where Ceres is converted into a resource hub, paving the way for humanity's expansion across the solar system. It's a clever framework using a space elevator, autonomous mining robots, and water-based propulsion to fuel interplanetary expansion. While engineering challenges remain, nothing is insurmountable with enough resources and determination. Imagine the possibilities once Ceres resources are unlocked. Not only would it open up the inner solar system and asteroid belt, but would be an obvious refueling stop to push on to the outer solar system and the rich resources in the Jupiter and Saturn systems. What are your thoughts on mining Ceres for water? Too ambitious? Or exactly what humanity should be doing if we want to expand throughout our solar system and beyond? Leave your thoughts in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. I recap the videos I posted this week, answer questions, respond to comments and chat messages, cover any missed news, and preview upcoming content. I'd love for you to join if you can. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.